So I'm talking about dynamic infrastructure and cloud computing. So I'm sort of approaching cloud computing from a very different direction. And let's see if we manage to reach cloud computing by the time my time runs out. Okay, so this is sort of a, you know, high level thing to start with. So we know about the world is getting smaller and the world is flat and all those things. It's also getting smarter in many ways. It helps that we are getting smarter, I think, but it's also other things in the world that are helping make the world as a whole smarter. So what do we mean here? There's a lot of technology going into day-to-day stuff, right? So it's not just about us developing technology in the labs or in universities and so on. It's also about applying the technology in mundane things like managing your traffic, managing water supply, managing electricity supply, and so on. Things in our day-to-day environment are getting smarter because we are instrumenting them, because we are putting in the ability to measure what's going on, to gather a lot of data, make sense of that data, and use that to improve the way these utilities are delivered, for example, or improve the way things operate in general in the world, right? So there are many examples of that out here, oil field technologies and, you know, supply chains and things like that. So like I was saying, it's basically all about instrumenting the world. And the amount of instrumentation that's going in is phenomenal, right? In various forms. So as it says out here, the world will be 10 times more instrumented next year as it was in 2006. And that number is actually going to something around 1 trillion instrument, you know, sensors essentially that are gathering data for us. And there are sensors of various types. I mean, there are the more obvious ones that you would have heard of, like RFIDs and so on. But even things like, you know, your set-top box, which gives you satellite, you know, dish TV and things like that, that has the ability now to record stuff, to understand what you're doing, which channels you're watching, for how long, and so on. And that data can be collected, can be used, can be analyzed in various ways. Okay? So there are many examples of that, as you see out here. Medical imaging, you know, all kinds of data being captured as part of the tests that we do in a hospital. Right? There's, of course, privacy implications out there as well, but it's useful to be able to access that data when we really need it. But the implication, of course, is that there's a huge amount of data being generated, and there's a huge amount of computing that has to be applied to that data if it's to be useful, right? Also, as it says out here, something like 70% of the digital universe currently is created by individuals. However, the job of managing that data falls upon the enterprises that help you to store the data and to analyze the data and so on, right? So enterprises are responsible for 85% of the implications of all that data, of managing the data, compliance and security and all those issues. The net result of this right now is that, you know, these relatively small number of enterprises that are trying to manage humongous amounts of data on behalf of the hundreds of millions of us, or maybe billions of us, who are on the net in various forms, is that the IT infrastructure that is being used to manage all this is at a breaking point. And there are various you know, data points out here you know, towards that effect. One of the things to note here is that, you know, as far as the spending is concerned on IT, what companies have to spend, 70 cents out of the dollar, 70% of the spending is basically just for treading water, for staying where you are, making sure things keep running, right? Just maintaining what's out there. And that's too high, because that means we don't have enough budget left over essentially to expand what we can do with all the IT that we have, right? And to keep up with the growth in the data, the growth in the applications, the number crunching that's needed, right? And there are various other things like that. We've already talked about the idle time in all these data centers, right, and all the computing infrastructure that we have. Because of inefficiencies in how it is used, typically you would find 85% idle time on many machines. Even the best managed data centers can only get it down to like 80%, 70%, those kind of ranges. Right? So obviously, you know, it's partly the IT infrastructure is at a breaking point because we are not able to manage it well enough, because we need better ways of running our data centers and so on. Okay, so that's why it's sort of time to start thinking a little differently about the infrastructure. And the point being made here is the infrastructure itself needs to become more dynamic. Dynamic in various ways. I mean, it's although we focus mostly on IT infrastructure, by the way, this also applies to other kinds of infrastructure that we use. So it could also apply, for example, to telecom infrastructure, right? Communications is so integral to everything that we do in IT as well, not just in our daily lives. So even those kinds of infrastructure, our mobility infrastructure, whether it is, trucks carrying goods all over the place, or whether it is people being shipped all over the place in trains and buses, efficiency in that infrastructure is also critical. So there are all kinds of infrastructure that needs to be managed in a more dynamic fashion. And IT can help to do that. That's the basic message here. So there are three things we need to consider out here. We've already, I'm sure you're familiar with virtualization. So in order to make the infrastructure more dynamic, what do we need? We need virtualization. Why? Because we can then share the infrastructure more easily. Virtualization lets us partition our resources into finer granularity chunks, which can be shared, thereby improving the utilization of the infrastructure as a whole. In order to do that, we need standardization, right? Because I have a bunch of IT workloads that I need to run. If I'm going to be able to run that on virtualized infrastructure and then move things around, then you need standardization of the platform underneath so that your applications can execute on different platforms and dynamically change based on the demand. And you need automation, because without automation, managing this sort of a complex infrastructure is next to impossible. So it's hard enough for enterprises to keep up with managing their IT infrastructure as it is currently. Once you make it virtualized and once you start loading servers up with more and more heterogeneous applications, which have different failure modes and so on, you have an even bigger management problem to deal with. And then humans, quite simply run out of the cognitive capacity to deal with those kinds of complexities. So you need automation in various ways to help the human administrators, to help the folks who are responsible for keeping things running. Because otherwise, without automation, without tools that help you to run your data center, there is essentially no hope of scaling beyond what we are currently today. And when you combine all these together, the net effect is that your costs can go down and your flexibility goes up, right? And we have seen this previously in history. There are other examples of this. It's not just about IT, right? So we've seen examples where, in the old days, there used to be telephone operators plugging wires into the boards, right? That obviously got industrialized. It got, automated so that we have automated switching now. And similarly, manufacturers. So even the Model T, the Ford Model T, the classical example of great innovation by putting in an assembly line and speeding up the production of automobiles. Even that still required humans to be putting the parts together. That has gone away as well. In most modern auto companies, you'll find that it's all robotics that's putting the car together. Right? So there's industrialization happening in various different domains. Banks, we are all familiar with this, right? Long queues in front of tellers have been replaced by short queues in front of ATMs. Some progress, at least. So it's similar with IT. There are different kinds of workloads, and we need to sort of analyze the workloads and decide how we can, dynamically adapt to serve different types of workloads. So the characteristics of the workloads are what will sort of determine the rate and the standardization of the underlying IT services that support them. Right. So there are different types of workloads that we can consider. There's analytics kind of workload. I was talking about the huge amounts of data, the need to analyze, derive patterns out of it, get business intelligence out of the data, things like that. Very different kind of workload is your collaboration workload. Large teams working together on projects, geographically separated and all that, they need tool support in order to collaborate, in order to communicate with each other, share documents, share data, things like that. Different workload, but nevertheless an important kind of workload to support. And then similarly, there are others like, development and test kind of environments, or you can have, at a simpler sort of level of sharing, you can have compute sharing and storage sharing as well, so that you put your, data on the cloud rather than having to have it all in-house, right? So essentially, the idea is to try and provide as much of self-service as possible to these end users who are using these IT workloads on the IT infrastructure, right? So you start with a self-service portal of some sort so that the end user can directly come to a portal and access services in as automated a fashion as possible. We're trying to minimize the need for IT staff to be to have to support these services and to be in the loop, so to speak. Right? So essentially, you come to a self-service portal, you raise a service request, in response to which the service gets provisioned. The necessary resources get allocated automatically in the background in response to a request by the user at a portal. And all this can be automated at this stage, right? Of course, as of today, enterprises or service providers are not yet comfortable enough with the idea of complete automation, which means that they would still want some kind of an approval phase in between out here. Before their infrastructure actually gets provisioned and given to the user to use, they want to have somebody, you know, controlling the gate and saying okay to go ahead or not okay to go ahead based on various business criteria. So there could still be a human step in this workflow, but it's still an automated workflow. So that human who's monitoring what's going on in the data center and deciding whether to offer this service or not to that particular end user only has to click a button on a console, or maybe just within an email you might have to click a link or something. So these workflows can be automated so that it's quick and easy, rather than having to, rather than having the human be a sort of bottleneck in the whole process. But essentially, you're getting a whole lot of automation that lets you create a dynamic infrastructure to support all of this. Which brings us to cloud computing in a way, right? Because now, in order to satisfy this, we need the ability to dynamically provision resources, and not just the underlying resources in terms of compute and storage, but also the application or the services on top, in response to user demands, in response to what the user is asking for from a self-service portal of some sort. So I don't have to go into the details of what public clouds are and private clouds are. Presumably that's pretty obvious by now, right? I mean, so public clouds, there are it's a spectrum of possibilities out here, right? So depending on the scale of your enterprise, depending on the scale of the services you're trying to offer, you might be okay with a private model, a private cloud model, which is purely held inside your data centers, or you might also prefer to go public in a sense and borrow resources from a public provider or lease resources from a public provider as and when you need them, right? And there are various considerations that come into the picture when deciding which models to use and things like that. So in many cases, security and privacy considerations could dictate the choice of a private cloud rather than a public cloud as of now. And these things help basically to bring down the unit cost by enabling economies of scale. So if you're doing it the traditional way, hosting all your infrastructure yourself in your data center, then the unit costs taper down only gradually, right, as the scale grows. You can build an internal cloud and bring it down much more significantly, essentially because you're sharing. You're increasing the sharing of resources using techniques like virtualization, server consolidation, and so on. And then for the service provider clouds, the public clouds, the scale can, this has started tapering much, much further behind, because basically you're operating at much larger scales and you derive those economies of scale. Well, it's a very gradual curve. Like I said, it started tapering way back somewhere, right? So typically we expect the service providers to operate at much larger scales than a typical enterprise. So, okay. So, I mean, there are various kinds of cloud-based services that can be offered, and I'm sure you've seen some variants of this before. So there can be infrastructure offered as a service, which is basically compute or storage kind of infrastructure, which can be rented on demand. There's platform as a service, which we've already heard about, right? The Azure example or Google App Engine and things like that. And then there's software as a service, right? Now, cloud computing is starting to encompass all of these things and sort of being used as a catch-all term for all of these. But really, our focus so far primarily has been on infrastructure as a service, especially within IBM at least, although we also have offerings in each of these layers, right? And so just in terms of terminology, basically trying to define that, the cloud is really here in the sense of, offering the infrastructure itself, in a form that the customers can use without caring how it's allocated, how it is managed, and so on, right? But typically, the users of the cloud are the ones which are offering services on the cloud or offering software as a service, So this software as a service, I think we should kind of leave it alone in a sense, and it already, there's already a good term for it, there's already a good space for it. And there's a different set of challenges in creating software as a service and in offering software as a service. Right? And then there's platform as a service in between, which again is a sort of niche in between, basically because you have somebody who needs to create software as a service but doesn't want to be bothered with managing all the infrastructure underneath. Right? So it's an in-between layer, and it's an open question as to how long it'll last, in a sense. I suspect that, you know, over time, parts of the platform as a service will gradually merge either into the infrastructure layer or to the software layer. Right? It's a development platform, essentially. That's what it is. Underneath, of course, in order to build infrastructure as a service, you need platform products. So you need the hardware and the software necessary to create the infrastructure as a service layer. Right? And there are some examples of that out here. And all the way on top, there is again something that obviously IBM is always keen to project, which is services. Right? Doing all of this is not straightforward, and therefore there is also expertise that can be offered as a service. Right? How to build cloud applications, how to build SaaS applications and things like that. So now this is an attempt to sort of show that there can be a slightly different approach to looking at cloud computing in this case, which is that you align the choices that you make, the kinds of cloud deployments that you consider, based on the workload that you are trying to host in the cloud. Right? So don't worry about the specific examples out here, but essentially the idea is that, you know, depending on the kind of workload you are putting into the cloud, you may have a range of choices of different kinds. Right? So at the bottom is basically the systems, the platform components, which let you create clouds easily. Then in between you have, you know, private clouds, and then you have public clouds or standardized services offered on public clouds. Right? So what is appropriate, what's the appropriate choice might depend on what workload you're trying to host on the cloud. So in the case of, you know, things like compute and storage infrastructure, it's perfectly fine to go with the public choices. And this is what Amazon is doing, right? EC2 and S3, basically. So the compute cloud, the storage cloud, if that is essentially what you're trying to request from the cloud, then it's fine to go with a public cloud and create your own layers on top, right? But there are cases in which you might want to move down to the lower layers, in a sense, either to keep things private within your data centers, or because, you know, there are prepackaged kind of capabilities that you would not get in a public cloud. The public cloud by default has to sort of serve the least common denominator of the customers, right? I mean, the request that everybody is likely to ask for, just because of economics, right? They have to be able to scale. And there are times when you cannot offer, you know, complex, focused services in a public fashion, because there won't be enough big customers to justify that kind of investment. So for example, you might have something called an analytics cloud, which offers the compute capabilities, but also offers the layers on top that do smart analytics of various kinds, business intelligence, of various kinds, right? So essentially you could, and secondly, when you're using something like that, you don't want to expose your data to the public cloud. This is, you're trying to derive business intelligence out of a collection of data. You don't necessarily want to put that data onto the public cloud and take the privacy and security risks of that. So you might want to have a hosted cloud, a private cloud within your own infrastructure, but be able to use that flexibly in the sense of, again, you know, these workloads will vary over time. You will only occasionally have to run your business intelligence workloads. So your underlying infrastructure can be shared and multiplexed across multiple workloads, whereas as and when you need the analytics workload to run, you have the cloud layer available there to run on the infrastructure, which can be obtained from your local private clouds. Right? And then there are other kinds of workloads. So, you know, for example, for collaboration, again, it makes sense. You know, everybody out here, I'm sure, uses web-based email, right? So it's software as a service, it's public, and we seem to be comfortable with doing that even with our private emails and so on, right? So it depends on the acceptance levels out there. But basically, yes, we can have hosted, public clouds hosting collaboration tools. And we have examples of that out here. Or you could do it in-house. So you can have a prepackaged sort of appliance which lets you create a collaboration infrastructure in-house. again using an underlying layer of flexible resources, compute and storage and so on. So there are many such examples out here of of workloads being mapped to, based on their characteristics, based on the sort of business requirements for those workloads, mapping them to the appropriate layers in the cloud, matching them to the appropriate cells out here in this grid essentially. So to summarize, we sort of approach this from the point of view of a smarter planet that we are trying to build out here, right? So there are a lot of opportunities that are arising because we are instrumenting so much, because we are instrumenting all our systems so much. And the net result of that has been that, there are newer kinds of IT and business services that are needed. They are emerging because we are generating all kinds of interesting new intelligence out of the world around us, right? And so it needs the underlying infrastructure. It needs service management systems. It needs the ability to deliver infrastructure to manage all this data and computing requirements in an automated, intelligent manner, right? So there's a whole lot of work needed in service management. And when we say service, it could be IT services, it could be other kinds of services as well. But those services have to be managed and delivered in an efficient manner if we have to have any hope of scaling it to the kinds of, scales that we are now considering, like a trillion devices connected to the net and so on. And then these, the cloud model, which is basically more of an IT consumption and delivery model, right, at the layers of the infrastructure and, infrastructure software and hardware. Those are already very compelling for some workloads. And we are in the process of sort of gradually testing the waters here with different types of workloads, testing out what kind of impact it has to be hosting your workload on a cloud-like infrastructure. And so that will evolve over time. And I already mentioned, there are various layers at which you can have various offerings to let customers dip their toes in the water essentially and try things out gradually so that you don't suddenly sort of start off with a public cloud and try to host your mission critical applications in a public cloud. Nobody's going to take that risk. But you can have gradual sort of graduated steps leading towards that, starting with flexible sort of appliance models within your data center, then going to a private cloud kind of model within your data center, and then gradually and in a controlled fashion, outsourcing your infrastructure needs to the public cloud. That's all I had. Thank you. Questions?
Yeah, nowadays I think we also started hearing about sky computing. I mean, can you say something about it?
I haven't heard about sky computing. So how is that
different? Across clouds, in fact.
Ah, okay. Okay, so there has been some effort to try and sort of standardize the interfaces to the cloud so that you're not stuck to a particular provider of the cloud. If you build on a particular platform, if you build on Azure, if you build on Google App Engine or whatever, then essentially your applications will only work as of now on that cloud. Some customers are not comfortable with that, right? Because they want the flexibility tomorrow if they fall out with Microsoft, they want to be able to move away from Azure, right? As of now, there are no standards. There is just some initial efforts at standardization. As and when that comes about, if that comes about, I should still put that if out there, then certainly yes, there will be the ability to, migrate workloads across clouds, across cloud providers. But frankly, that's too far in the future right now, and I'm not too sure that it's a complex technical problem to solve. It's just a matter of agreeing on standards as far as the API layer is concerned, as far as the platform layer is concerned.
Yeah. Sir, what is the scope of cloud computing in manufacturing industry and sector? And how cloud computing and dynamic infrastructure will be helpful to make smarter the industry?
Okay, so in the manufacturing industry, just to give an example, I mean, these automobile companies, right?
Yes.
They have to do a lot of number crunching as well. They do a lot of simulations and so on when they're doing, especially in the design phases, right? And again, so it's more of compute workloads that they have to host. And
basically in the workshop, like when CNC machines and other machines are operating there, how it will reduce the cost of the industry?
I'm not sure that cloud computing directly address the the CNC machines and the assembly process itself.
Yes, sir.
But there are other ways in which they end up needing IT infrastructure, which can certainly be virtualized and shared and so on. Not sure if cloud computing can address the actual sort of manufacturing process itself.
Yes, thank you, sir.
A high value business transaction, say banking, your large database base, you want a secure commit happening. That kind of a workload is more of otherwise the compute workload where you want a huge amount of design kind of thing. So you got large databases doing a large number of transactions. You want an update to be committed.
So there are business reasons why you would typically not want your
If say you set up your own private cloud, is this technology really amicable for that? I have a 4 or 5 applications running. Each of them are a critical transaction, independent application. Right. They happen to be a common, what you call a platform infrastructure.
Right.
Is it feasible for me to have a ubiquitous, a farm of a machine, a layer of a database, a service?
Absolutely.
Running
yeah.
a, is it feasible?
And yeah,
is
I would it say so. Certainly within your data center, you can have a more flexible infrastructure that way. You can have a farm of database servers.
So
like
is
you
it
said.
Feasible for us to one and define a business rule, a kind of a rule engine, that if the utilization goes in one server beyond a point, kick off a second server or a do the vMotion of the entire image
Absolutely.
From one to other,
Absolutely.
Is easy to do that?
Right. The same sort of graphs that Varsha showed, right, would apply also to transactional kind of workloads.
Okay.
So depending on the kind of transactional workloads you're seeing, you could certainly scale up the infrastructure that you have at the back end, the database servers that you have at the back end.
You just mentioned there are really no standards today. Let's look at simple thing. Virtualization basically is core to build any cloud.
Right.
There are competing virtualization technologies.
Right. Even that is not a standard.
There are no standards. So you will not be able to move an image of a working image and a Linux guest OS working in VMware into a Red Hat virtualized machine. Today there are no way to negotiate that I would like to transfer image from a one so people offering me a.
So there is some progress on that front, at least in terms of virtual images and so on. There is something called the Open Virtual Format (OVF), which lets you do some mapping of images across some platforms. Depends on who conforms to what standard, to what extent, and so on. But that there is progress happening there, at least. Yeah. Sure.
Especially with reference to the private clouds that you mentioned, would you consider private clouds as a means of providing IT service management, as one means of providing the IT service management to
Absolutely.
The company?
Yeah.
So you look at cloud computing as a means for the IT service management?
So there are two aspects to this. One is the cloud computing itself, I mean the cloud itself can be used to host your IT service management applications. So there are multiple automation kind of tools that are needed. Those could be part of the cloud.
So the superset actually would be IT service management,
yeah,
and the clouds
so.
Would be a means to an end.
Sure, clouds would be one part of delivering IT services. I mean, IT service management would encompass clouds as a way of sharing your resources efficiently, but it would also need the other automation tools and so on to keep the cloud itself running in an optimal fashion and things like that.
Okay.
Thank you.